Last week we looked at our need to be like Jesus, who was seated in the heavenlies, even though he was here on earth. Remember from John 3:13 it actually said, and Jesus who is seated now in the heavenlies, he's talking about himself, the Son of Man who is seated in the heavenlies. Well, he wasn't seated in the heavenlies, was he? He was down here. But he was modelling to us the fact that even though we're here facing a whole load of circumstances we don't want to face, we can be seated with him and see it from a heavenly perspective and expect God to do things. How many of you want to seek in the heavenlies more than you are now? Okay, we all need to, because then we can see what God is doing. Is this on, John? Oh, it's me. 1, 2. See, Jesus, everything Jesus did in his life actually modeled what we can do as human beings. He didn't come down in his body and be automatically God in his body. He had to grow in his faith. He had to learn the scriptures. He had to learn how to pray. He had to learn how to rely on God to do miracles. He was God in his body, but he was showing us how we could live just as he lived. So he was seated in the heavenlies, we are seated in the heavenlies. He did miracles, we can do miracles. He had a strong spirit, and he could face opposition. That passage that we read last week, Jesus just healed. Who did he heal? Story, come back to head. The man at the pool of Bethesda. And then the Jews sought to kill him, and they persecuted him from that day forth. You know, a lot of the persecution we suffer is the enemy without. Some of it comes from people, but most of it is the enemy trying to destroy our faith. To say, well, did God really say? Can that really happen? That's where most of our persecution comes from. Society is putting down walls in persecution. You can't do that. You can't say this. You can't wear that. All those things are persecution, but it's very mild. And we need to be able to be strong in our faith, even in the things that the enemy throws at us and what is around us in society. One day we may face more severe persecution, but we are being tested now to stand firm in our faith. And we need a strong spirit to do that. Let us read together this passage of scripture from John chapter 5, verses 19 to 25. Jesus gave them this answer. I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he does. Yes, to your own amazement, he will show him even greater things than these. But just as the Father raises the dead and gives him life, even so the Son of Man gives life to whom he pleases to give. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son, just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who has sent him. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, I just thank you for your word. I thank you for the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible and every word that's therein. Every space, every dot, every tittle. Lord, it's all there for a purpose. And I pray that you would reveal to us this morning the purpose of your word and what it means to us individually and corporately. Lord, that we may walk as Jesus walked. That we may learn to be strong in spirit. That we may grow in faith. That we may be like Jesus. Lord, that we would be your ambassadors here on earth. Father, I pray that your spirit would grieve upon our minds to make us receptive, that your hands would work on our hearts to soften them, to receive your word, and that it will grow and bear fruit this week, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, one of the things I'm experiencing at the moment, and it must mean that I'm getting younger, is that sometimes when I close my eyes, I have vision movies going on in front of my eyelids. And I'm thinking, crumbs, young men are meant to have visions, old men are meant to dream dreams. And I remember, as we were singing that song, when we walk upon the water, you know, God, I saw a crowd of people, and many of you were included in it, actually walking on water. You know, the day of God parting the water, which is nice and safe, isn't it, because we can walk through on dry land, has come to an end. He's not parting the water anymore. He's putting the waters, whether they be waters of trouble or physical waters, we are going to walk across the top of them. Because he made all things possible. We read that passage of scripture, which is immediately following the ones we looked at last week. Sorry for all the visitors. We looked at John 5, 16 and 18, where the Jews actually went after to persecute Jesus and to seek to kill him. For 3 years he was under oppression of the Jews, always looking for an excuse to actually kill him. Can you imagine what it's like to live under that sort of oppression? And that's what Jesus... And then he says these things, that I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself, but only what he sees the Father doing. He was actually putting a nail in his own hands on the cross by saying that, because he was actually saying to the Jews, I am God's Son. God is my Father. And I only do what I see the Father doing in heaven. How dare anybody out of the religious system in those days actually say, I am doing what my Father does in heaven. How dare you say to your boss, I'm doing what God has told me to do, even though it may cost you a job. No, these are the days that we live in. We've got to be so certain of our identity in Christ and the power that he's given us to actually go out and do what God tells us to do. You want to see God now? You're okay. The bodyguards at the back. They're just making sure you don't leave before the end. And if you're scared of them, there's another door here. I think this just shows us what a strong spirit Jesus had. We're having a flash mob sermon this morning, so people who have got various passages will get up and speak out loud what's on their piece of paper. Don't wait for the prompt in the future.
When your spirit is alive, when somebody has got a strong spirit, they could be on the verge of death physically and they leak out more life. That's what William
has done. Amen. William survived 11 years. He's got a strong spirit. He's a fighter. He's carrying on. And despite all the things that come against him, there's still life leaking out of him. What about you? Is life still leaking out of you despite all that comes against you? I trust you, because if you know Jesus, it can. Because he said in that passage, I am the one who gives you life. And it wasn't just meaning about eternal life after we die. He meant, I give you life in abundance now. The trouble is, our circumstances tend to make us think this isn't very abundant. But compared to hell, it's very abundant. Very abundant. This is the closest you'll get to hell if you're a Christian. Life on earth. Yeah? This is the closest you're ever going to get to hell. You've no idea what hell is like. We've got something better to go to. And now we're expecting to see God's kingdom manifest here on earth in our lives. Amen? See, Jesus, I believe, leaked life all the time. Even when he was on the cross, he leaked life. Because look at you. Look around you. Look at all the people that he's leaked. Ever thought of yourself as a leak of Jesus? Not a vegetable. Yeah. Right. Next one.
True happiness leads forward to a strong spirit that is undefeated no matter how trying and difficult.
Thank you, Wendy. That's a bloody statement, but it's still true. You know? True happiness means forging a strong spirit that is undefeated no matter what the circumstances are. You know, when the doctor said I had to have a knee operation, and I phoned up the garage and they said my car's still not ready, and various other things, I'm thinking, you know, God is bigger than all that.
Yeah.
God is bigger than all that.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen.
Because His Spirit in me is stronger than my spirit.
Amen.
And I need His Spirit to join with my spirit to make me strong against all the circumstances. I'm sure many of you will have seen pictures like this. There are three types of person. There is the spiritual life, where everything that we do is governed by God working in our spirit, making us feel the way God wants us to feel, making us do what God wants us to do, and not dominated by the circumstances around us. The middle person is a soulish person who does what they want to do without consulting God, behave the way they want to behave, totally governed by their senses, their feel, their touch, their sight. Everything that comes and they see in the world determines how they feel. Circumstances determine how they feel. Smells make them want to eat food even though they've probably eaten too much already. I bear testimony to that. That's the solid bit of me here. Yeah. So often things influence. And then there is a physical life where everything is about you and not about Jesus. Put it simply, that's it. See, many of us might be what Paul would call a carnal Christian. What is a carnal Christian? Let's hear what Paul says. You ready to go?
Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, and is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can it be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. And if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his.
That's a big challenge for us, isn't it? Are we in the flesh? Oh, sometimes we are. Sometimes we do what we want to do without consulting God. Let's be honest. But I trust that God is working on your spirit so that you become more sensitive to what God wants you to feel in the circumstances. You know, He wants you to be a rejoicing, happy people, despite the circumstances. He wants you to make decisions based on what He says, rather than on what the world would say. We are constantly under attack in this world because the enemy is constantly appealing to our soulish desires. It's constantly working to destroy any relationship that we would seek to have with God. Constantly trying to get us to do what He wants and what we want rather than what God wants. The spirit within us needs to get stronger and stronger all the time to respond to God. You see, a carnal Christian has been defined as one who is weak in spirit but actively pursues their emotional and physical desires without being subject to the Spirit of God. And many of us find ourselves doing that occasionally, hopefully, on days when things are not going right. Or on days when our mind is off of God and we think, yeah, I'd sooner do this. We're called to seek after God, to seek after His heart, to be like King David, to do what is right in the sight of God. I talked about Asa, Abijah and Jehoshaphat the other week. And they are people who set an example, who seek after God in all things and had peace on every side and didn't have to fight battles. How many of you would love to be living in peace? Well, we are in Christ, but we can have peace greater than that when we seek after God. God is a God of pleasure. You know, He doesn't want to squash all your desires because He's giving you many of those desires, many of your desires for pleasure. And He rejoices over us, and He created feasts and festivals. He intends us to eat. I am so pleased. He intends us to eat lovely foods. I'm so pleased. He intends us to have great parties. But we can go too far. We can be gluttons. And God doesn't want that. He wants everything for our good. But pleasure outside of God's purposes is destructive. If you have too much food, you become bigger. You become unhealthier. You might die early. Now, for those who are going to heaven, you might think, well, that's an advantage, but you know, God would sooner you came in his planned time rather than the time that you're setting for yourself by the way you eat. God is not a party pooper. He's not trying to squash your pleasure. He has made judgments in Scripture. He's set down guidelines for us to live, not so that we're restricted, but so that we're protected. You know, he's like a parent who does not give the child a carving knife. That's why most of God's guidelines in the Bible, most of the laws, are actually to protect us, not to destroy our pleasure. The trouble is, most of the world thinks, oh, you're taking away the best bits of life. No, he's not. He's actually protecting us from doing harm to ourselves. God's laws are protection rather than punishment. Unfortunately, the world's got a twisted view that his laws are punishment. Mike Bickle says, God's judgment is aimed at whatever interferes with our love of God. Most of his guidelines are there to actually enable us to have an intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father. Who wants to be intimate with God? You'll have the best life going if you are. Here's a typical picture of soul, body, spirit, soul and body. God works in our lives from the spirit to affect our soul, our mind, our emotions, our decisions, our intellect, our desires. He works from the spirit to change our soul, which will be better for our body. That's how God works. What we are surrounded with and the enemy works is he works on the outside. He appears to our soul to make us disobey and ignore God's guidelines. How many of you know that saying? You are what you eat. Yeah. I must be a mackerel today. I had mackerel last night, but the more we consume of Facebook, we become Facebook. The more we consume of TV, we become like what's on TV. The more we consume of God, you'll become like God. We have to be really careful about what we give all of our time and attention to. You know, advertisers appeal to our desires, our emotions, and our fear of pain. All of the adverts are actually trying to get you to buy their product so that you feel better, you're not afraid, and that you have what you want. That's an attack of the enemy. Because it's not appealing to what God wants you to do. The trouble is that the news does the same thing. They fill us with fear. Has Trump pressed the button yet? Has Kim Jong pressed the button yet? No. But they're all telling us it's going to happen any minute now. To send people into a spin of fear and wondering what's happening next. As Christians, we're going to praise the Lord because Jesus is coming soon. It doesn't matter what happens.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what happens, does it? But we can pray. We can be watchmen. We can pray that God's will be done. His kingdom come. At this moment in time. And guess what? Politicians do it as well. You'll have seen in all the campaigning, in all the recent elections, and all the more elections we will have. They're after what you want, rather than what is best for the country. That's why they make laws that permit abortion and same-sex marriage and all the other things that come along. Because it's about appealing to what people want and not protecting what God has. The world is no longer governed by morals. There was a time when people had morals and knew what was right and wrong. We're no longer governed by morals, but by desires. Can you see that as a plan of the enemy? You know, we'll destroy, the enemy said, I'll destroy what God put in man, the best thing for man. I'll make them so self-centered, so full of desires, that we'll create laws that enable them to do anything. In fact, one of the things that scared me this week, that I was reading, it may be fake news, but it said in Australia they're currently looking at making paedophilia part of the curriculum for safe schools. Huh? Yes. That's how crazy we are in today's world. Let's have a look at John the Baptist. What's it say? Oh, blank. We've got that one. Pop it.
And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the desert until he appeared publicly to Israel.
Amen. Amen. This is a passage about John the Baptist. He grew and became strong in spirit. You know what? You're not strong in spirit from the day you became a Christian. We have to give attention to growing strong in the spirit. John the Baptist had to develop a strong spirit. In fact, he did it, same as Jesus, for 30 odd years before he came into ministry. He had to have a strong spirit to do what God wanted him to do. Because to preach the gospel of righteousness and to baptize people into repentance and to tell the Pharisees they were rude and vipers and all the other things, he needed a strong spirit to get out and do what he was called to do. We need a strong spirit to come against what the world thinks is right. Who's got the next one? This is about Jesus, I think it's Mieka. Thank you, Yetta. See, both John the Baptist and Jesus, as children, grew strong in spirit. All you children, there's hope for you yet. You've got more years to grow strong in spirit than we have, the rest of us who have got left. But if they gave attention to growing in spirit, then do we not need to give attention to growing in spirit? For our identity and our character to be formed the way God wants it to be. For the ministry that God has for you as an individual and us as a body of believers. Every one of you has unique opportunities to be like Jesus in the situation and amongst the sphere of influence that you have. We all have a mission. Amen. How did they grow strong in spirit? Well, I suspect they devoured the testimony that their parents gave them about what happened around their birth. Because they would have had, you know, can you imagine Mary saying to Jesus, you know, the angels appeared to all the shepherds in the sky. Now, you either think your mum's cuckoo, or you think, well, what's all that about? So he probably searched the scripture to find out. You can pull that blind down, Jennifer. Sarah's being blinded by the sunshine. See, they probably went to search the scriptures to ask questions to find out what their personal testimony was all about, what God had done in their life at that particular moment in their life, and what it meant for their future. See, in the natural, we get hungry by not eating. But in the spiritual, we get hungry by eating. The more we eat of the Word of God, the more we want to know the Word of God. The more testimony experience, the more we want to experience. I've asked you to share your testimony with somebody else this morning to make them hungry, to go after more of God. That's what church is about. a fellowship of believers who share testimonies that make other people hungry so that they pursue after God the same way as you've experienced joy. And if you can't just do it from the testimonies of individuals, which is current and relevant, you can do it from what's in the Bible. You know, you can part the waters and lead a people through the Red Sea. It wasn't just unique for Moses. Every testimony in the Bible of what God has done for people is an invitation for us to experience the same. Jesus said we will do greater things than he did. That's more things, but also anything that's in the Bible is possible with God's leading for us to do as well. Don't limit God. How many of you are good at limiting God? Most of us. We won't think of, well, I know one person that sometimes is here, does try to walk on water quite frequently and sings. But it wasn't led by God. But at least he's trying. At least he's trying. And maybe one day he'll have a testimony of somebody who sees him doing it. They'll say, oh, God must be with you. Good old Simon. It's not surprising he sings, but never mind. I won't go into that.
Was your faith?
I'm still trying. John the Baptist and Jesus became strong in spirit because they hungered after the things of God. And they devoured more of the word to find out why the testimony that they had in their early life, what it meant, what's in the word about it, and then they grew strong knowing that this is what God had planned for them to do. And that's why their birth and all the things that surrounded it were miraculous, and they continued to walk in the strength of what God set them up to do. You know, just you try having a study on prayer. Get your concordance out, or get your e-sword out, or whatever you use to look for passages on prayer. The more you read God's word on prayer, the more you try it and see that it works, the more you want to find out about prayer. Yeah? The more you read about the miracles that Jesus did, the more you'll want to experience it. You get hungry by reading the word of God. See, God's word wants to cut into you and to change you. Change you from a physical, soulish person to a spirit-led person that believes what Jesus did, what people in the Bible did, you can do too. He wants to cut into every area of your life. Here's a challenge. Do a study on handling finances as determined in the Bible and see how much better off you will be. You should get hungry by doing that. Most of you won't even go there for fear that you might have to give more. But I won't go there. Who's got our next passage? Luke 31, 1-3. Now children, this is the start of the passages that have Bible names that are in your word search. They're highlighted in red. So if you want to write down those names that are highlighted in red, then you can try and find them in your word search.
Now, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, being the governor of Judea, Herod, being tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea, and the region of Trachonitis, and Lysanias, was tetrarch of Abilene, while Annas and Caiaphas were high priests, the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins.
Now that's a challenge. I gave that passage to Anne to read and she chickened out. And then Marguerite was saying, how do you say this? How do you say that? There are spare word searches, more than the children could have, so if you want the challenge of finding some of those difficult names in a word search, you can have fun. It gave me about 2 hours of work last night trying to stick all those names together. See, this is the beginning of John the Baptist's ministry. How do you, without becoming strong in spirit, enter into preaching the word of God in that historical context and to go out into the wilderness? Goodness knows how long he was in the wilderness. I don't know whether it was 30 years or whether it was from his bar mitzvah until the start of his ministry. But he spent a long time seeking after God and what his call was. And he didn't go out into the wilderness until he heard the word of God come to him to say, go and preach the word of righteousness and repentance and baptize people. He knew, because he came from a religious family. His father was a priest in the temple. He knew that he was going to upset the apple cart, if you like, and do something that only the religious elite were allowed to do. And he was going to go out and baptize. And the Spirit of God was upon him, because he must have been anointed to do this. Because no person can go into the wilderness and have crowds come to them to hear the message that he's preaching unless the Spirit of God is upon him. That must have been mind-blowing to John. How would you, what would you think if you went into the Sahara Desert and started to preach next to an oasis pool because God had told you to? Would you do it? Probably not. Some of you might have a bit more faith and go out and do it. But what would you think when thousands of people turned up to be baptized? You'd have known that God was in this, wouldn't you? You see, we don't put ourselves in these Bible characters' shoes very often. But just think about it. What's God saying to you today? Where is he telling you to go and share your testimony? Where is he telling you to go and preach the word? Where is he telling you to go and heal somebody? And you're thinking, well, there'll be nobody there. Or there'll be nobody there that needs healing. Well, if God has told you to do something, they'll be there. You know, John, there is always a cost to what God calls us to do. And the big question is, are we willing to pay that cost? Are we willing to look an idiot? I can remember Linda one day going out of our house when we were living in York, kneeling down in the middle of the road to pray for our neighbour, thinking that she was being absolutely stupid. But you know, it led that woman to come to faith, because she came out and said, what are you doing? I'm praying for you. See, God will ask you to do some crazy things sometimes. Now, I believe that the testimony of John determined his strong spirit and his identity. Just think about it. John will have been told, no doubt, by his father Zacharias, that an angel called, children, Gabriel, it's in red on the screen, Gabriel, and Zacharias, in Luke 1, 11. An angel turns up. Can you imagine being visited by an angel and he says, do not be afraid. Be full of great joy. Yeah, you've been scared out. As I heard somebody say the other day, he might have filled his pampers. I don't think Zacharias was wearing pampers, but, you know, it would have shocked him. He has this angel, one of God's big angels, appear to him and say, do not be troubled. Your prayer has been heard. If you read William Barclay's commentary, the actual translation is, the prayer that you no longer pray has been heard. Because Zacharias, in his old age, and because his wife was barren, had probably stopped praying for a son. But God had heard the prayers when he was a younger man. And he still held those prayers in his memory. And in his time, he decided to come along and shock Elizabeth and Zacharias and give them a child. I bet there's prayers that you've prayed that you haven't heard God. answer yet. But he's still got them on his record. He's still got them on his record. He hasn't forgotten. Some of your prayers might have been dumb prayers or silly prayers. You might have asked for something which God knows better that you don't really want, but he knows your heart and he knows what you really need, and he'll give you something different than what you've asked for, and it'll be far better. You ever wonder what God does when he is praying for something? It's like, I'd like £1 million for it. No, you wouldn't. Yes, I would. And Jesus says, don't listen to that. He actually just wants to be prosperous. Give him prosperity in every area of his life, rather than £1 million. Amen. I've prayed some silly prayers in my life. I thank God that he's not answered every one of them in the way I wanted him to. But he has answered all my prayers. He always answers all of our prayers. Not always the way we want them. And sometimes the answer is no. But more often than not, his answer is, well, I know what you're saying, but I actually think what you need and what you're feeling is this. Because he knows our heart. And here's silly old Zachariah. He says, you've got to be kidding. To Gabriel, God's big messenger. Anybody dare say, for any angel that appears, no, you can't. Nah, it's not possible. So he was struck down for 9 months. Ever wonder why he did that? Probably because he had spoken negative things and stopped God fulfilling what he planned to do. See, Elizabeth, name, children, was barren, according to Luke, name, 1:7. And Mary meets Elizabeth, and the baby jumps, leaps for joy, and Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit. These are all incredible things. Can you imagine Elizabeth saying to John, you know, when I met Jesus' mother, you leapt inside me, and I was filled with the Spirit. What's that mean? John would be saying. What's that all about? Why was it? Why is it so special that when I met Jesus' mum to be, I leapt in your womb? I better go and find out. I better search the scriptures. I better seek God. I better pray. I better find out. See, he experienced all these things. The next slide tells you the one I've already mentioned, that crowds came to him. He was the man who, under the power of the Spirit, prophesied, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. You know, he knew that from Scripture, from experience, and from the Holy Spirit. He knew because of the testimony of his mother about his meeting when they were in the womb. And he obeyed Jesus and baptized him, even though Jesus did not need to be baptized. See, I believe he became strong in spirit because he seeked after God about the testimony that surrounded his life. He studied the word and he obeyed the word. He knew that God had a plan for his life. Do you know God has a plan for your life? Before you were made, I formed you in the womb. I have a plan for all of you. Yet John the Baptist, who was strong in spirit, had a moment of doubt. Who wrote this one?
Matthew 11:2-6. But when John heard in prison about the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said to him, are you becoming one, or do you look for another? Jesus answered and said to them, go and tell John the things which you hear and see. The blind see, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me. Amen.
John the Baptist was having a bad day. He was looking at the circumstances. He's in prison. Herod had had him arrested. He probably knew that death was on the horizon. It was totally unjust, because he was doing what God had told him to do. Ever been there? You think, I've done what God told me to do, and I'm still in a mess. Or I'm in a deep mess. He was a bit depressed, I suspect. And he sends disciples to Jesus and asks him, are you the one? How come this doubt has crept into his mind, given that he said, behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world? Because the devil had got in, used circumstances to degrade his faith levels. But Jesus, typical Jesus, typical God, doesn't answer his question. He doesn't say, yes, I am the one. It points to what God had already revealed to John the Baptist, that the Messiah would come, he would heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead, etc. Jesus says, look, I am doing exactly what you're expecting the Messiah to do. Why did he answer the question in that way? I think he wanted John to end his life convinced that he had done what God had called him to do. That he had done the right things. He wanted him to end well. He didn't want him to give up on his faith. You see, he didn't say death won't come near you. He said, look, you've done everything. I am pleased with you. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to have to jump through these. Look at Jesus. Can you imagine Jesus growing up and his parents telling him all the things that surrounded his birth? What would you have thought if your parent told you, an angel appeared to me in a dream? And this is what the angel said. Children, there's another name on there, Joseph. An angel appeared to Joseph 4 times. He told him to take Mary as his wife, to go to Egypt, to return to Israel, and to go to Galilee. I like angelic appearances, but Joseph had special. He had lots of them. He had messengers come to him to tell him the word of God. And then wise men, royal people, not three. We get confused with the carols, we three kings of Orient. No, there were 3 types of gifts, but there are possibly lots of wise men, lots of royal people come to Jesus. And what do royal people bring to a future king? They don't just bring them a bunch of flowers and a box of candies, do they? I mean, look at the Queen of Sheba coming to Solomon. She brought masses of riches and supplies. And it says gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Don't know how much. But can you imagine Jesus going into Mum's bedroom one day and saying, what's all that gold doing there? How come nobody else in the neighbourhood has got that much gold, or that much frankincense, or that much myrrh? What's it all about, Mum? You know? Well, what's it all about, Heavenly Father? What's it about, Joseph? You know, the wise men were warned in the dream not to go back to Herod. Mary gets to meet Gabriel as well. He says to her, greetings, O favoured one. Favoured one? I'm favoured and I haven't got a husband. And my boyfriend's actually going to leave me because I'm pregnant. This is favour. Ever been like that? Wondering the favour of God looks a bit peculiar. Mary meets Elizabeth and the baby leaps, so she also has the experience. Shepherds see angels and come and visit the child. What? Shepherds on a hill see a load of angels and they come to see a baby. in a manger. What's that mean? Well, it's in the Bible, in the Old Testament. And if Jesus, and I presume he did, searched the scriptures, he would find all these things. He would find all of the places that the angels told Joseph to take him to, but also in the Old Testament. More names for the children.
If I put that slide up.
No. Simeon sees God's salvation in the temple. Another bears witness to it. And at 12 years old, Jesus is in the temple, amazing the scholars. How do you amaze scholars? Unless you know the plans of God. Unless you know the word of God. He searched the scripture. I know he became hungry to know what God has done with his parents and at his birth. But he searched the scriptures, he devoured them, and he became strong in spirit. Here's one of my favourite passages of scripture. Let's read this one together. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true, and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey, and a honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is great reward. You know, there's so much truth in that psalm. There's a great song to it, and I'm not going to try and sing it because I've beckoned you. But the law of the Lord is perfect. It converts you. It changes you. When you consume the word of God, when Jesus and John the Baptist consumed the word of God and how it affected them, it changed them. It converted them from being mere human beings with no identity to being the people that God made them to be. And the same is true for you. The beauty in that next verse is the testimony of the Lord is sure. All of your testimonies are unique to you, but they make you wise because you're simple. And they will make other people wise too, because they will become aware of what God has done and what God can do for them as well. There's so much importance in testimony that this verse is only perfect. Your testimony is pure because it's what God has done. Nobody can question it. They might doubt what you say, but you know it's true. And the statutes of the Lord should be rejoicing your heart. And the commandments of the Lord should be enlightening the eyes. I've encouraged you to write down some testimonies to share with people. I've already said that every testimony is an invitation to experience the possibility of what God can do in your life. There were no super saints. You know, Moses wasn't any more special than you. John the Baptist wasn't any more special than you. He was God's chosen vessel for the ministry at that time. And you're God's chosen vessel for where you are placed and to work. Anything that God required them to do, he can require you to do. And it is possible in Jesus Christ. Do you want to raise your spirit? Do you want to have fun? Well, here's my suggestions. Get together and share testimonies of what God has done. Amen. That's the greatest fun you could ever have. Yeah. To know what God has done in each of us lives. And you know what happens when you do that? This is what I believe happens. I believe the angels look down on your sharing your testimony and they get excited about your view of what the Redeemer has done in you. There is a heavenly presence around you when you share your testimony, because you're lifting the name of Jesus high. You're lifting the works of God high. You're opening the heaven's gates. And joy in the heavenly places. And if that doesn't change the atmosphere, nothing will. And I'm sure it does change the atmosphere. They are fascinated, the angels, all the heavenly beings are fascinated about your views of your Redeemer. And the atmosphere will change.
Amen.
The atmosphere will change. That's why I've encouraged you to share testimony today. So after we've sang the next song, I'm going to encourage you to pass around your testimony. Give it to somebody you don't know. Give it to wherever God leads you to. But encourage them that God can do for them what He does for you.